Oh, I am a lonely cowboy, and I'm off on the Texas train. My train is cinching saddles and pulling bridle rein. But I can twist the lasso with the greatest skill and ease. Or rope and ride a bronco most anywhere I please.
Kenneth Allen Maynard was born in Vevey, Indiana on July 21, 1895. From his youngest years, Maynard wanted to be a cowboy. When he was just 12 years old, he ran away from home to join a Wild West show, but his father, William, brought him back. Nevertheless, he remained obsessed with his dream of being a rodeo star. When he was 16, he joined a touring carnival. By 1914, he was the leading attraction at the Kit Carson show. He moved around from one circus to another in the intervening years, and when war broke out in 1917, he joined the army as an engineer. After the war, he returned to the Wild West show circuit, joining with the Ringling Brothers Circus in 1921. That same year, he met Dell and Bug Jones, who convinced him to go to Hollywood. He appeared in various small supporting roles for a few years before William Randolph Hearst cast him as Paul Revere in the 1924 film Janus Meredith. After this, Maynard signed a contract with Davis Distribution to star in 8 low-budget westerns released between 1925 and 1926. It was during this period that he married his third wife, Mary Lieber Maynard, on the set of one of his pictures. Maynard had earlier gone through a rather rushed marriage with a girl in Kentucky while he was stationed there during his time in the Army. He had also married Janae M. Knutson a few years earlier. Both of these marriages were short-lived, but Maynard would stay with Mary until 1939. The same year that he signed on with Davis, Ken acquired his famous horse, Tarzan. A golden palomino, Tarzan can be distinguished by the small dark birthmark located on his right haunch. Like Tony before him, Tarzan's fame was not the result of studio publicity, as would later be the case with Gene Autry's Champion or Roy Rogers' Trigger. Rather, it was the horse's genuine talent that endeared him to audiences. Trained, according to Maynard, to follow verbal instructions, the horse could be seen to dance, bow, or roll over and play dead at Maynard's command. The horse and rider would become famous for the increasingly outrageous stunts they would perform in camera. According to film scholar John Tuska, Maynard loved his horse in a manner that he never loved a human being, and Tarzan returned this affection. When Davis Distribution went out of business in 1926, producer Charles R. Rogers approached Maynard with an offer to star in a high-budget series of westerns released by First National Pictures. This studio was on the rise at the time, having recently built a 62-acre lot in order to expand into film production, having only been a distributor prior to this. Hoping to match the success of Tom Mix at Fox and Hoot Gibson at Universal, their contract with Maynard stipulated that they would build him into a star, and that Tarzan would receive billing. Charles Rogers would produce the films, and Sid Rogel, a shrewd businessman, was brought on to manage the financial side of things. Rogel's brother, cinematographer Albert S. Rogel, was hired as the director for the series. Harry Joe Brown, who would later work with Bud Boddicker and Ranald Scott on the famed Renowned series of westerns, was the associate producer for the Maynard series, and even directed a few of the entries. Brown and Rogel had both worked earlier in their careers on FBO's series with Fred Thompson. Screenwriter Marion Jackson was brought on as the scenarist and scriptwriter for the series. These films were enormously successful and set a new standard for the series' western. Maynard's films became known for their fast pacing, complex stunt work, and lighthearted stories. Brown kept the cost for the films fairly low, not usually exceeding $80,000. He came up with the idea of shooting series westerns 2 at a time to save on cost, an innovation that would later be borrowed by David O. Selznick for Tim McCoy's pictures at MGM, and by Harry Sherman for the Hopalong Cassidy movies. Footage from these movies would be reused by various studios for many years to come in series westerns. His series for First National solidified Maynard as a major western screen hero. When his contract expired, Harry Joe Brown approached Carl Lamell at Universal with a proposal to do a series of westerns with Ken Maynard in the same vein as his first National Pictures. Maynard would receive his own production unit, and was given creative control over his movies. He would produce 8 westerns for Universal between 1929 and 1930. Spurred on by the success of In Old Arizona, Maynard decided to include musical numbers in these movies, making him the first real singing cowboy. The advent of sound made the production of outdoor pictures a financial liability, so Universal decided to cease its production of Western films for a time, and Maynard's contract was not renewed for the 1930-31 season. It was at this time that Maynard and Harry Joe Brown parted ways.
Get on the wagon, that old bandwagon.
Ken then signed on to star in 11 westerns for Tiffany Productions, a Poverty Row studio. This was a major step down for the actor, who was used to much higher production values and much higher salary. After Tiffany went belly up as a result of the Depression, Maynard moved on to Worldwide Pictures, for whom he would star in 8 westerns. He was given more creative control over these films than he had at Tiffany, and the budgets were generally higher.
We got him!
What happened? Soldiers!
Round up that gang, boys. I'm going after Eileen. Go ahead.
As his career went on, Maynard became more controlling and increasingly difficult to work with. He'd often lose his temper with the other cast and crew, and, more critically, with the people he worked for. The relative success of his series for Worldwide led to Ken's return to Universal in 1933.
Come on, boy. Get out of here.
Once again, he was given his own production unit, and even bigger budgets than he had been given before, around $100,000 per film. The 8 films he made for Universal during this period are generally considered his best work in the sound era. Unfortunately for Maynard, he often went over budget on these pictures, and his bad temper got him in trouble with Carl Lamell and other Universal execs, so his contract was, once again, not renewed for another season. Nat Levine then persuaded Maynard to do a serial, Mystery Mountain, for Mascot Pictures. Once again, his ego got in the way, and his constant tampering behind the scenes angered Levine, so Maynard left Mascot after doing just one more picture for them. He then did a series of 8 pictures for Columbia, who were searching for a replacement for Tim McCoy. After this, Maynard left Hollywood for a time to do a brief tour with the circus. In 1937, he signed on to do 4 westerns for the Poverty Row studio Grand National Pictures. These films were made quickly and cheaply, and Maynard's career was on a sharp decline. After another series of 4 films for Colony Pictures, Maynard retired from the screen for a time to focus once again on the rodeo circuit. It was during this period that he met and married his last wife, Bertha Maynard, who was a high-wire artist at the Cole Brothers Circus where Ken was working. Ken would briefly return to westerns in 1943 to star in the Trailblazers series for Monogram Pictures alongside Hoot Gibson. Maynard was almost 50 years old by this point and was more ornery and hard to work with than ever. Unhappy with his pay and with being saddled with a third lead in Bob Steele, Maynard left the series after just 6 films.
So long, Miss Anne. Enjoyed working the show.
I enjoyed it too. Bye.
Snap out of it.
He would do one more western, Harmony Trail, for Walt Mannix Productions in 1944, before fading into obscurity.